They claim the train station missile strike in eastern Ukraine was committed by Ukraine, despite all evidence to the contrary.
Hey all, I'm John Avalon, and this is Reality Check. The world has been getting a crash course in Russian disinformation during their invasion of Ukraine. It's a place where the party line overtakes reality, where the war is not a war, where Ukraine is not even a real country, where evidence of war crimes is dismissed as fabricated or even blamed on the victims, where the fake killing of kids is used to justify the actual killing of kids. Yes, it is sinister stuff, but it's also completely predictable, because propaganda warfare is a never-ending story from the Kremlin. In fact, Stalin is often credited with coining the Russian version of the word disinformation. And the Russian regime's enemies at home and abroad have long been its targets, especially the people of Ukraine. And that's why the fact-check organization Stop Fake was founded in 2014, to counter the fire hose of falsehoods that were already inundating their country. It's a website pumping out videos and a TV show dedicated to setting the record straight. And now, with blood and tanks in the streets of Ukraine, their work is more urgent than ever. The people of Stop Fake have been pioneers in the open source disinformation wars. They are journalists combating state-sanctioned lies on the front lines, taking the incoming fire that comes with that principled position. And that's why I wanted to speak today with one of the founders of Stop Fake, Professor Yevhen Fedchenko, so he can puncture some of the propaganda from the Russian invasion of Ukraine, and even more importantly, take us through the lessons he's learned about how to most effectively combat disinformation. Yevhen, welcome to Reality Check.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me.
Tell us how you and Stop Fake have been approaching your jobs in wartime.
We've been mapping the main narratives of Russian disinformation, and the main there, for example, to prove that Ukraine is not a real country, or Ukraine is a fascist state, that Ukraine is conducting genocide against people living in Donbass.
Kremlin has simply decided to gather arguments in support of its fabrication that the Ukrainian military committed, quote, ethnic cleansing, unquote, that is, genocide in the Donbass.
And when Putin started just to reinforce and amplify those messages, it was clear that it becomes a focal point for Russian politics. This war was created in the minds of Russian policymakers to the point when they cannot differentiate for themselves what is real and what is not. For example, they were absolutely disinformed about the state of Ukrainian armed forces, for example, because they just wanted to believe that Ukrainian armed forces does not exist, that Ukrainians would welcome Russian forces. And they took military decisions based on this disinformation.
You founded Stop Fake in 2014, even before an invasion and annexation of Crimea. Mm-hmm. Tell folks about why you felt the velocity of disinformation coming from Russia demanded a full-time fact check.
When occupation of Crimea started, as journalists, we realized that we need to respond to the vacuum of information, because if you have some vacuum of information, it's always used by disinformation. And the answer was, let's use fact-checking to tackle disinformation.
Apparently, eastern Ukraine wants to unite with Russia, and in response, NATO troops have entered the Donbass. And remember that explosion in Beirut? That's right, they found evidence of Ukraine's involvement there too. Welcome to Stop Fake, the place where we break down Russian disinformation about Ukraine and a little more.
It helped to build resilience among Ukrainians to Russian disinformation.
Now, one of the ways that you've disseminated Stop Fake is through a television show, which has actually become one of the most popular television shows in Ukraine. How did you make that leap?
Back in 2014, television was a main platform which was used by Russia, because all Russian TV channels were fully available in Ukraine. So we decided that in order to get to the same audience, we need to use the same platforms.
One of the other points that I've heard you make and your colleagues make is about the politics of disinformation, specifically the way that Russian disinformation tries to use the far left and the far right against the center. Explain.
what Russia is doing right now is just continuation of the old Soviet policies, where they've been actively dealing with far right, far left in Europe, in United States, to find the cracks in the societies and just to make them bigger. They want to use those far right and far left parties. They want to help them from the fringes of political spectrum to more to the mainstream, and they provide them with media support through Russian disinformation platforms. They provide them with talking points, and that works very, very well with some countries.
And is that because they can exploit a conspiracy theorist bent that is shared on the far right and the far left from your mind, because the goal is to confuse?
Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly what happened with MH17, for example. So they've been just throwing contradictory theories, who did that, why they did that, and people just were confused about what really happened.
Very quickly, it became clear that the downed plane was a passenger plane, and Russian media quickly changed their narrative from one of a victory over Ukrainian Nazis to blaming Ukraine for the downing, creating conspiracies that even said Ukrainian fighter planes shot down the Boeing.
When we come back, the founder of Stop Fake will tell us some of the best practices he's learned in almost a decade of combating Russian disinformation. That's next. What are some of the best practices you have learned about combating disinformation? You said one thing we need to do is take disinformation seriously. Explain.
You really need to listen to what those people are saying, because that's a basis for their policy making, actually. You need to take seriously and sometimes literally what they're saying. People were just saying, well, yes, it's just, you know, overblown, but actually nobody believes that. But the problem is that a lot of people believe it.
So when Putin says that the Ukrainians are committing genocide, that becomes an indication that indeed the agenda might be genocide.
Absolutely. So they're just kind of mirroring and projecting everything on Ukraine, what they are going to do. And also we can use those pieces of disinformation to make predictions for their policy making.
One of the challenging things you say is deplatform disinformation wherever you can. But that does run into basic principles, certainly here in the United States, of free speech. How do you navigate that in your mind?
We should recognize at the very beginning that disinformation is not journalism. So if they are saying that Ukrainians should be killed because they are Ukrainians, this is a hate speech, this is a warmongering and many other things, but not definitely journalism. So if we can remove them from social media, if we can remove them from media to do not provide them a voice, and if we would do that 8 years ago, probably would never have this war in Ukraine happening in the first instance.
Yevhen, you and your team at Stop Fake are fighting the good fight on the front lines. Stay safe, and we wish you well.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on Reality Check.